so confused. I know I heard you loud and clear, so I follow through. Somehow I ended up here. I don't wanna think, I may never understand, that my broken heart is a part of your plan. When I try to pray, all I got is hurt and these four words: Thy will be done, Thy will be done, Thy will be done. I know you're good, but this don't feel good now. And I know you think of things I could never think about. It's hard to count it all joy, distracted by the noise, just trying to make sense of all your promises. Sometimes I gotta stop, remember that you're God and I. Like a child on my knees, all that comes to me is Thy will be done, Thy will be done, Thy will. I know you see me, I know you hear me, Lord, your plans are for. Goodness you have in store. I know you hear me, and I know you see me, Lord. Your plans are for me. Goodness you have in store. So Thy will be done, Thy will. Like a child on my knees, all that comes to me is Thy will be done, Thy will be done, Thy will be done.
Ooh. Ooh. Hi. Good day, Saint of Jehovah. Here is Pierre Calava, the pastor of Oasis Church, Cape Town. Once again, I'm coming to you today so that we can share the scripture, the word of God in this time, the time of confinement, the time which the world is in the deep crisis. And I believe the Lord has assigned us for a time such as this, in any position, in any situation, to work and expand the kingdom. So this, the message which we're starting today, I hope some of you been following me on Facebook in the past weeks. Last month I spoke on the prayer of David, the song of David. We spoke on the Lord is my shepherd, the confident prayer which David prayed, and the prayer which never disappear, the song which never vanished, the song which is still singing and in our lives up to this day. Now, that is the Old Testament. As I promised, we also gonna have a time to deal with a new prayer that the Lord Jesus Christ taught his disciples. While in the New Testament, we have the prayer, which is called the Lord's Prayer. Now, I'm not going to start straight with the Lord's Prayer, but we're going to get there. So it's a series of teachings which we'll be sharing together during this week or 2 weeks. And I'll invite you to pay your attention. I will invite you to focus and to follow every sessions of this part of teachings. My main topic in the message which we'll be dealing with will be getting the kingdom right within the church. Getting the kingdom right within the church. You may ask why? Because if we don't get the kingdom right, and we will not get the church right. So it's so important for us as believers, children of God, to be mindful and to get understanding of the kingdom of God in order for us to run the church or to serve God in his church according to his will. So my main topic, even as I'm starting with my introduction today and the part one, I will like you to take note of main topic, which is getting the kingdom right within the church. And we will also do the part one today, and the next session we go to part two. The question might be why we should get right the kingdom within the church. Because the church is the subject to the kingdom. The church is the subject to the kingdom. And in order for us to understand the kingdom or work good in the church, we need to have the mindset of the kingdom so that we can serve the king according to his will. Now, what is the kingdom? That will be another question. So the kingdom simply is the king with his ruling domain. So you cannot be a king without being or having a domain. So the kingdom, we see the king with his ruling domain. Who is the king? The king, as we see many kingdoms on this planet. Of course, we, for those who live in Africa, they know the kingdom of Swaziland. And for those who live in Europe, they know Belgium Kingdom. They know also about British Kingdom. So we know about many kingdoms on this planet. And also we should know about the Kingdom of Korea. North Korea, they also have a king. I like to refer myself to that kingdom. Because most of the time when I see the country, when I see the way they serve, people serve their king, especially in that kingdom. And you know, they see that king as a great man in the entire world. A powerful man, influential man. So we refer that the king rules over his domain. So the moment we understand the kingdom, then we will understand the church, which is the church, is the assembly of the saints who are seeking for the kingdom of God. So it's just simple as that. You understand the kingdom, and then you know how to work in the church, because Christ says that I will build my church. We are servants in the church, but Christ, he is the king of the church, or the head of the church. So the king is a sovereign person, is a monarch. The king is the one who is distinguished above all others of his compares. So we have to understand the kingdom as the higher place, the higher place, the one who is great and enthroned in his domain. So I believe all of us, as we are here now, we understand the kingdom. Of course, you and I, we know Jesus Christ as our King. It's so important as we start in this series of teachings to understand that in this time, what can be the purpose or the DNA of the kingdom? The DNA of the kingdom is the calling of the disciples. So I would love to read with you in the book of Mark, chapter 1, Mark chapter 1, verse 17. Before we go to Matthew, let us just go to turn to the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 17. What the Bible teaches us. The word says this: "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make of you fishers of men." So here we see the calling of the disciples. The Lord Jesus Christ, the man of prayer, the man of the Spirit, God in flesh, he was very strong in prayer, and he also called the disciples in order for him to make of them fishers of men. So that is a key or DNA of building or serving in the kingdom of God. Also in the book of still in the book of Mark chapter 1, if we read from verse 35 to 39, the Bible speaks about Jesus Christ praying. He went and prayed, and after that, as people were looking for him, even his disciples, when they found him, he said to them, "Come, let us go, so that I may preach also in another town or another village." So they went together. He went and preached there. But the Bible described that he went first to the isolated place. He went such place and he prayed in isolation. As they found him, then they joined him. He said to them, "Let us go and preach also the gospel." So, as I said, the DNA is the calling of the disciples. As the disciples are called in the kingdom of God, we all have to understand that is the key. Now, we also see that Jesus Christ, in this purpose, he came on this planet. The main purpose he came in order for him to win the lost. He came to preach the kingdom, the gospel of the kingdom. He said in his word, "This good news of the kingdom of God will not pass. Will go up to the four corners of the earth. And then the end will come." So there won't be end. Maybe we are crying. There won't be an end now unless you and I, we take note, we become serious, we say, "Okay, it is the time for us to preach the good news of the kingdom." Glory to Jesus. So the main reason he came, as I said, that he came to preach the good news of the kingdom. Well, in order for us to understand what was in the heart of Jesus, or in the heart of God for us, for his kingdom to progress, we have to understand that we need to deal with the prayer and the preaching of the gospel. few things which we're going to have to understand here, or what we have to keep in our studies, is that the kingdom, prayer, and the preaching of the gospel. It's all important. So let us start with part one as we going to study this together. In part one, I will have a subtopic which will be called Practical and Purposeful Manner of Prayer. A practical and purposeful manner of prayer taught by our Lord Jesus Christ. So the Lord Jesus Christ taught his disciples manner of prayer, how to pray. He did not tell them to repeat the word which he said, but he gave them the outline of prayer. Some of us, we pray, many people complain that God does not answer our prayers. But we have to understand that praying is talking with God. When we pray, we should be frank. When we pray, we should be sincere within us. When we pray, we have to know the same as the Bible teaches us, that Jesus talked with God. And also, he taught his disciples to pray. Jesus talked to God. He spoke with God, and he also taught his disciples to pray. Very important. Most of times we just go into the prayer like that. We complain that the Lord is not answering our prayers. There is no glory of God in our prayers. But I want you to understand. You have to see the outline with the Lord Jesus taught his disciples. It's so important for us to be taught the manner or the way in which we should approach ourselves to the Lord. It's so important. We need to remember, when we pray, God responds to our prayers in three different ways. The Lord may say yes, the Lord may say no, the Lord may say wait. And all these three, it works in his will. Only if these prayers goes according to his will. As we pray, we shouldn't just pray for what we want, but we must pray for the needs of our lives. And when we pray, there are times that the Lord refuses to give us what we ask him. Does not mean he's not there or he stopped being God. He's still God. But we only have to understand that when we pray, God can say no. God can say yes. And God can also say wait. Waiting of the Lord might take you 5 years, might take you 1 year, might take you 3 weeks, might take you 4 months. It's depending on his own time. God works in his due time, not according to our times. James chapter 4 verse 3 speaks to us in this way. When you ask, you do not receive, because you ask with the wrong motive. You watching me right now, you are there in this moment. I don't know what you're facing, I don't know what is your situation, but what are you asking God, and why are you asking God this? That's a good question. What are you asking the Lord, and why are you asking that to the Lord? So important. So we have to know, when we pray, it must go in the will of God. But James says that we don't receive because we have the wrong motive. James 4 chapter 3. So it says that we are praying in order for us to spend what we receive or what we get from the Lord in our own pleasures. Go read that scripture on your own. Go understand that. When you pray, what are you praying? What are you asking the Lord? So what is the motivation beyond your prayer? Is it in the will of God, or is just your own will? Then we come to this book of Matthew chapter 6, which we call the Lord's Prayer. When the disciples saw Jesus performing miracles, when the disciples saw the life of Jesus, the life that he lived on this planet, his life impacted their lives. They were touched. They were so motivated. Now, it became difficult because they could not perform, they could not do what he was doing. So they had to come with a request before the Lord and ask the Lord, said, Lord, teach us how to pray. So this is a part of the Sermon in the Mountain. The Lord Jesus Christ with his disciples. So they came to the mountain as he was teaching. Then they understood that it's so crucial, so important for them to ask the Lord to teach them, so that they can live like him, so that they can speak like him, so that they can pray like him. We have seen how you're doing things. We have seen the power that you is coming out of you. Now teach us also to pray and to be like you. Then the Lord gave them an example of prayer, which you and I today we call the Lord's Prayer. But I believe that this shouldn't be the Lord's Prayer. Shouldn't be called the Lord's Prayer. This is the disciples' prayer. It shouldn't be called the Lord's Prayer, though we do. But I firmly believe that this should be called the disciples' prayer. Why? Because the Lord Jesus Christ told them to elevate his Father, of course, for all his life. He was elevating Father. He was elevating Father. He called God always Father, Father, Father. Only one place Jesus called God, my God. He called him my God. It's only when he was on the cross. Why? I believe because he was separated from the Father. He was full of sin, of your sin and my sin. But on himself, he never sinned. That's why he communicated with his Father. But when he buried your sin, my sins, so in that time, he could not be called the child of God. So he called my God, meaning my creator, my Lord. Why have you forsaken me? This prayer is in the book of Matthew chapter 6, verse 9-14, even to 15. Now I want us to read, if you have your Bible with you, I'm going to read, but in our teachings, we will deal more with verse 9 and 10. But let us read from verse 9 to 15. The Bible speaks this way. This name is how you should pray. This name is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. 13. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. 14. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. 15. But if you do not forgive men they sin, your Father will not forgive your sins. We will deal much with verse 9 and 10, but here at least we understand as the Lord Jesus Christ taught his disciples the way to pray, how to pray. He did not teach them to pray, but he taught them how to pray. So, teaching them to pray, they had to practice what they saw him doing. But teach them how to pray is to give them the outline of prayer, meaning in each and every circumstance, this is how you should approach your God. Now we will start on this verse 9. Even to verse 10, but I want us to understand the main purpose or the motivation in this prayer is goes in this outline. You and I, we have to call the kingdom of God to come on earth. That is our prayer. That's our prayer, to pray to the Lord. The kingdom of God to come on earth. So it's our responsibility to cause this kingdom. And also, when we pray this prayer, we have to understand and be very careful, paying all our attention on the outline with the Lord Jesus Christ gave us in the prayer. Because in this chapter 9, we're going to understand that when it goes even to 32 to 33, Jesus saying that things of the world, God will give us, he will add it to us. We don't need to focus on that. He gave even the illustration of the birth. So we don't need to focus on the social goods, but we have to focus in the kingdom of God. Now, the first point when Jesus starts teaching this is telling them to call our Father. But before even we go to our Father, I want you to understand that Jesus did not teach us or taught his disciples to pray for the cause. Not praying for marriage, not praying for promotion, not even praying for houses, even money. No, I don't think so. The Lord Jesus Christ taught his disciples to pray in the outline which he gave them. But when we live with our five senses, we focus more on the things that we see, things that we hear, that we can touch, that impact us much. And we forget the outline which the Lord Jesus Christ gave us. Especially most of Pentecostals, you know, and we get focus out of the outline of the Lord, and we just focus on the things of prosperity gospel, and forgetting that that is just the benefit which the Lord can just add in our lives. But a point or the focus of this prayer is what we are going to learn here today. So is into that, as we understand the fervent prayer or the practical prayer, we understand that we have responsibility to cause the name of God be revealed on the earth. I want you to take note of that. The name of God to be revealed on earth, and to cause the kingdom of God to come on earth. This is how Jesus taught his disciples to pray. The name of God to be revealed on earth, the kingdom of God to come on earth, as well the will of God to be done on earth. And the four is that as it is in the heaven. Now I want you to think with me together. Come on. I want you to reason with me. Even the book of Isaiah speaks to us. Come, let us reason together. Let us reason in this outline of prayer. How do you approach the Lord in your prayer? It's so important. Do you cause the kingdom of God to come on this planet? Do you cause the name of God to be revealed on earth or to be elevated? Our Lord be your name on earth. Even the will of God to be done on earth, I don't know. So this prayer, which we see in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 and 10, this prayer is addressed in three directions. And I'm going to describe in this first part the three directions of this prayer. So the prayer starts with God, the prayer goes to man, and the prayer goes back to God. I want you to understand that the existence of you and me, it was not out of our own will, but it was in the mind of God, in His will, before even you and I to exist. The Bible says God loves us first. The answer which I never get from the question on the planet is that, why God loved us first? That is His own secret. Why God loved us first? You have a reason you love your husband. You have a reason you love your wife. You have a reason you love your children. You have a reason you love the people that you work with them or you meet on the planet, your sisters, your brothers. But if you are giving the question, you answer me why God loved us first. So this is to understand that first in everything we do, the name of God is greater. The name of God to be great. So as I said, that the prayer is divided in two parts. It starts with the Lord, it's come to men, and it goes back to the Lord. In everything you do, I will continue, but I want you to pay attention with me. Paul says that we are of God, from God, we live for Him, and if we die, we die for Him. I have a principle, or I always say that if I live, if I exist, every circumstance of my life, I call it God. God is the circumstance of everything in my life. If my hands can shake, can move, I believe the Lord is allowing it to move. So the prayer comes for the glory of the Lord. The prayer comes the Lord, what He's doing in our lives. And the prayer comes for glory, goes back to the Lord. So this is called the twofold invocation of doxology. The twofold invocation of doxology is actually the three divided parts of the being of all existing for the Lord. The three divided parts of worship. Number one is the honor that accords to worship. What honor that do we give to the Lord? What honor do we give to the Lord in our worship? Recently, I received a video of a lady actually praying for the Lord to give her just one child. As she's been praying, and worshiping the Lord, worshiping. So in the video, it's made like the angel is coming, the child is crying, and the angel is coming to deliver the child to the lady. And then suddenly the phone rang in the bag, and the lady just dropped on the prayer and answered the phone and said, "Oh, I'm in the prayer. I will call you back. Oh, it's that angel. Okay, I'm coming now." So she just changed the direction. She stopped, and the angel disappeared. The angel just turned back and went back with that baby. Worship. Doxology. Elevating the owner. Praise, elevating the Lord. Praising God. Exalting Him above all. Seeing that He is the reason of our existence. He is the reason of everything that is happening. He allows it. He allows it. The glory to Him. The second point is the humility that recognizes that our dependence is on God. Still, when we go to the worship, because the worship is the act of bowing before the King, Your Majesty, Your name be allowed, you know, Your name be exalted, Your name be elevated, Your name be sanctified. The part of worship. Worship is not a praise. Worship is when you start contemplating and elevating the majesty of the Lord. Seeing Him higher than all. Telling Him how great He is. Praising. Worshipping the Lord. Unloading yourself, you disappear so that He may appear. You humble yourself. You decrease so that the Lord will increase in your life. So the third one is the hope which the role of God creates. As we worship Him, as we elevate Him, as we give Him glory, we have to believe and understand that this is the God who is the Creator. And He rules over everything. He is our Lord. He is my King. He rules over me. No one else will take His place in my life. So, this is the core. Requires more attention than what we could see and meet. We pay more attention in what we see. We pay more attention. We focus on Him. We forget everything. We disappear. We just see the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord in our lives. So when we read this verse 9, verse 9 is divided in two parts. Like I already gave you the three points which is so important in our part of doxology, in our part of worship. So we see verse 9 is a part B and part A and part B. We see it. We see verse 9. The Lord Jesus is telling the disciples, say, you should be praying in this way when you start praying. Now, part 1 or part B, it goes, part A goes in this way. Our Father in heaven. What does that mean? Why did not He tell them that my Father was in the heaven? He says that our Father, it's not focusing on self-centered prayer, but it is approaching God. You are approaching God with a relational. You are approaching God relationally. Understanding that one Father is the Father of many. One Father with many children. It's so important. Our Father. I don't know if you have ever come to the point of, you just boasting of your father, my father. You know, I used to be like that. I grew up like that. Self-centered. I called myself a daddy's boy. You know, my mother make food at home and all children will go on the table to eat. I won't eat. I'm just waiting until my father comes and then I'll eat with him. So anyone, my big brothers and sisters, they can't beat me because I saw myself, I was a baby's boy. So I thought, maybe I was thinking that he is not their father. I just going back to my childhood, you know. Was he not their father? Was he only my own father? No. Our Father. So this is a way of approaching God. Understanding God that God is a Father in relation with many, not just with myself or yourself. Even the one you think is in the world is still his father, though he's lost. That's why we have to study this prayer. So we have to understand that our Father who is in heaven, it says that our Father who is in heaven, the Father of many. So part B of verse 9 goes to speak that hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed in Greek, it means that a secret name is sacred, is separated, and a unique name. No other name can be compared with other name, with that name. No other name will take the place of that Father. Yeah, we have our fathers. You know, in this world, I found that there are three fathers. The physical father. Also, the father when Jesus told the Pharisees that they was your father. Because if God was your father, you could have loved me and you could have believed me. And our heavenly Father. Our Father who is in the heaven. Maybe a physical father has disappointed you. Maybe you never met your physical father, your biological father. Maybe you have so many disappointments with your biological father. You don't have a good memory of your father. But that does not exempt the love which your heavenly Father has for you. Our Father who's in the heaven. Not our Father who's on the earth, but our Father who's in the heaven. The unique name. You know, to treat the name as the kind name, the only kind name, the holy. Your name be sanctified. Your name be blessed. Your name be revealed. Your name be deified. Your name be separated with all other names. Our Father who's in the heaven, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Your name be blessed. Your name be exalted. Your name be worshipped. Your name be praised above all name. So I don't know, as you and me living on this planet, what name you do elevate? What name do you worship? The Bible teaches us in the book of John chapter 1 verse 12, to those who received him, Jesus Christ, he has given them the right to become the children of God. Not of those who are born of the flesh, but born of the Spirit. You see, where you are a child of God, not to become a son of God, but to become the children of God, meaning that that God is our Father. That's why Jesus taught his disciples to pray. So as we learn to pray in part one, we understand that we need to be sincere in our prayers, knowing that we have a Father who hears us in the heaven when we pray. Knowing that he is a faithful God. So today, I'm ending here with you. Just to make you understand, to make us understand that this Father who is in the heaven, his name deserves to be sanctified. His name deserves to be worshipped. His name deserves to be praised. So in this, we will go and continue as we continue with getting the kingdom right in the church. May God bless you. Hoping to see you next time. Thank you very much.